year was very much about influence and the way he's influenced via cinema and the way his cinematic brain works. And this year, the follow-up to this conversation is going to be much more skewed towards process and how he specifically goes about work. So I'm excited all of you are here, and I will bring out the legend himself, Kojima-san. Maybe. Okay, one second. I'll just talk to you guys in the meantime. I've been spending an enormous amount of time with him for things that we will talk about at another day. But truly, he has one of the most interesting brains in the world, I think, not only as a game designer, but just a consumer of media, just content, science fiction, and everything. He's an enormous dork, which is always very nice. But eventually he'll come out on stage. Stretch it out, they say. How are you guys doing? Good. Did you guys see the Death Stranding trailer?
Yeah!
When people ask me about the Death Stranding trailer, because I'd seen it months ago, no spoilers, but they were like, what's it like? What's it like? And I was like, well, it's great, because it's very Kojima-san, because people are going to watch it, and they're going to say, I still don't know what this game's about, but I'm excited. And I think he's probably one of the few people on the planet who has that ability and can get people excited about a game on an R2 level. So once again, Kojima-san.
Hi. I'm back.
And once, as always, the trusty Ken to translate. So like I said, last year was about influence. This year we've spent so much time together and I want to talk about process. One of the things that you told me, I just took him to Super Potato, which is a very nerdy store in Tokyo. It says old school games. And he picked up the Mario cartridge, the original Mario, and he said, without this game, I wouldn't be doing this. And he said, there's two simple buttons. There's jump, basically. There's run and jump. So when you saw that, what made you think, I can be cinematic with this art form?
ですね、まあ当時はその表現力が全然なかったので、カメラワークは当然使いません。キャラクター喋れません。
So back then, all you had to, there were only so many things that you could express. You couldn't change the camera, you couldn't play with the camera work. It was very limited.
なんでいわゆる映像で見せるというよりは、ゲームの画面でいかにドラマとか演出をするかっていう、まあ、テキストも含めてですけども、そういうことで、まあ、映画ではないですけど、映画の手法ではない方法で、なんとかそのストーリーとドラマを伝えようとしてました。
So back then, more than images, what you were just trying to see what you could represent in terms of drama, in terms of story, whether it be through text, it was something completely different from movies, which was a challenge, how to convey something similar, stories and stuff, using methods so different from those that were available in movies.
まあ、十字キーと A ボタン、 B ボタン、それだけで、マリオはものすごい冒険をプレイヤーと共にしてくれるんですよね。でそこに感銘を受けて、当時は、まあ、カメラワークもできませんでしたけども、いつかはそうなるっていうのを、未来が分かってましたんで、それで、まあ、ゲーム業界に飛び込んだんですけども、こんなに早く、まあ、映画に追いつけるというか、映画のような画面が作れる、音響が使えるっていうふうになるとは、まあ、当時は思いませんでした。
So all you had available for the player was having the D-pad and the A button and the B button, that was it. And only using that, the player was led to so impressive adventures. Mario went through so many adventures. That's the one thing that impressed me. So I couldn't play with the camera work, but I knew that one day I would be able to, all these elements would make it into games. I knew I could see that future coming. The one thing I didn't imagine was that they would come so fast. So I knew that eventually those methods available to movies would be available for us, but I just didn't see it being happening so fast.
で、まあ、三十数年前にマリオに出会って、まあ、そこでゲームの可能性に出会って、今の僕があります。
So 30 some years ago, I had my first encounter with Mario, and well, that's what led to who I am today.
で、まあ、昨日デストランディングの新しいトレーラーを公開しましたけど、まあ、詳しいことはあまり言えませんけど、マリオっていうのがやっぱりゲームの最初にあって、そのマリオがずっとやっぱり、ゲーム業界とゲームの中で、まあ、深く根付いてるんですね。でゲームっていうのはマリオと一緒で、普通の人よりも速く走って高く飛んで、空を飛んだりする、すごく自分ができないことをゲームというあのバーチャルなところで超能力を発揮する、それを、カタルシスにするゲームが多いんですけども、デス・ストランディングはその真逆を言ってます。
So yesterday also I showed theA trailer for Death Running. I cannot go into too much detail about that, but Mario is at the basis of games. Is there, you know, the basis for so many games where Mario tries to go faster than faster, jump higher, and some games that you can fly, do whatever you want, have these unusual abilities, and through those exploiting those abilities, give a catharsis to the player. Now in Death Running, I'm trying to go for the opposite of this.
あのデスストのノーマンは、小石につまずいてこけたりしますし、荷物のバランスをであの横に傾いたりしますし、 川で流されたりもするという、これもマリオがあってのことです。
So in Death Stranding, Norman can trip into stones, needs constantly be careful with his balance when walking, can be taken away by a river, and all these elements are there because of Mario.
I just like to think about when we were in Tokyo, you said to me that you originally wanted to be a director, and that sometimes you feel trapped, you felt trapped in the game industry. And then you said to me, but ultimately you're so proud of the fact that you're working in a medium that didn't exist when you were born. And I thought that was really touching. And I just love to think about this kid who saw Mario and then thought, one day I'll make an hour-long unskippable cutscene.
スキップできない1時間のアドリンを持ったんですが、とても本当に感動を受けましたけど。
So, if you had to describe the way your personal style has evolved cinematically and the way you tell stories from way back in the day making games to the MSX to now, how would you describe that evolution?
ですね、まあその MSX の時なんですけど、ゲームっていうのはまあ、敵がいて自分がそれを倒すっていう、そういうルールですよね。それしかなかったんですよ。でなぜそいつが排除されなければいけないのかっていうのも全く説明がなかったです。
SoBack in MSX, for example, you had an enemy and you had to defeat the enemy. There was no way, that was the only thing, that was your role. You were never given a reason why you have to defeat that enemy.
で、まあ、そこに僕はすごく疑問があって、で、そこを説明したゲームを作りたいっていうことなんですけども、つまりそれはゲームにドラマがなかったんですよ。キャラクターの意思とか動機とか背景、モチベーションが描かれてなかったので、それを描こうとしました。
So I had questions about that. I wanted to make a game that explained that, which in other words means that the games didn't have drama back then, and I wanted to add these dramatic elements, a will to the character, a motivation, a reason why a character is doing something.
とはいえ、当時のキャラクターは、顔もなくて、まあ、ドットなんですけど、顔もなくて表情もなくて、言葉も持たない、そういうハードだったので、それが今や喋、って表情も動きもその年齢も説明しなくていいんですね。ビジュアルで 何歳ぐらいの人で性別も分かって、大体どういう人種の人かも分かる、服装とか、持ってる時計とかイヤリングとか装備品でその人の背景が分かる、そのぐらいのディテールが描けるようになったんで、当初やりたかったことが今ようやくできるようになってきたという感じです。で、ゲームをやっててよかったなと、途中でやめずにやっててよかったなと思います。
So back then, characters had no face, had no expression. I mean, they were dot, it was dot art, so they didn't have no, they didn't have words. That was the hardware back then. Nowadays, though, the characters talk. They have their facial expressions. They have their own unique movements. You know, you can convey all these things just visually without needing any need to explain this. What race they are, the clothes, what kind of accessories they wear, the equipment, all these details. Finally, now today we can convey them in the games. And, you know, looking back at that makes me feel really happy that I didn't leave the gaming industry before. I'm just happy to be here.
I want to talk about the sort of hidden and invisible, in my assessment, Olympic-sized backflips that you do with your cinematics. And specifically, all of you should go back and watch not the most recent Death Stranding trailer, but the last one. Or you should go and look at a lot of the cutscenes in Phantom Pain. Because he's gone from a world of very traditionally cinematic cut, angle, new angle, cut, to these very long, unbroken takes. And normally in cinema, you see a virtual camera, and it reeks of being computer-generated because it's doing these long, sweeping moves where it will zoom across a landscape in 3 seconds. It feels naturally CG. But you started doing something where you started taking that virtual camera and making it feel handheld. And so you would do these very long, unbroken takes, and they're incredibly long, but they feel fluid and they feel authentic and they feel natural. And I think you were one of the first people doing that. And now you see things like God of War, and it's one continuous unbroken take throughout. You guys should go and watch those cutscenes. I want to talk about that process. How did that come to you? How do you block a scene in the midst of that technique? To me, it's sort of a groundbreaking thing that hasn't even been done properly in film yet. It's a very new thing. So I just want to talk about where that came from.
ですね、そもそも、ゲームって一つのカメラなんですよね。プレイヤーが操作しているカメラでずっと進んでいきます。
So first off, games is one rely on one camera, the one camera that is following the player.
3D になってからですね。3D になる前は二次元なんでカメラじゃないです。フレームしかないんで。
First
off, 紙芝居です。
All that started in 3D. Back then, when it was only 2D, it was just there was no camera. But this concept of the camera started with 3D.
でプレイヤーのカメラが一つでずっと。まあプレイヤーの視点のゲームはありますけど、でカットシーンになると全然違うカメラになる。というのが、まあ、昔のゲームですね。これは仕方がないので、そこ CG ムービーとかなんで、あるいはアニメーションのカットシーンとかありますけど、そこでいきなり違うカメラに変わります。
So, the camera now when we go into 3D era, the camera is constantly following the player, or well, there are some games where the camera is from the player's perspective. However,you're playing, and then when it comes to the cutscene, then the camera has to change. This is inevitable because of technology, because back then it was pre-rendered movies or animations, and it just took you out of there, the camera changed.
で、これ皆さん、ちょっと誤解されてるんですけど、普通ゲームシーンとカットシーンって同じところで作ってません。ほぼ、ほとんどがそうですね。カットシーンは映画会社とか別のところに作ってもらってます。演出をしているのは別の人です。
Now, one thing that most people don't get right is that in most games, game scenes and cutscenes are made separately, are made in different places. For the most part, cutscenes are directed by someone else, by a filmmaking company.
で、僕はそれが嫌なんで、ゲーム中のカメラの演出もカットシーンも当然ゲームクリエイターが同じ人物がやるべきだと思うので、で、両方やってます。
And I disagree with this method. I think that whether it's in-game camera or cutscene camera, the same person that is directing the game should be directing this.
で、本当の理想形はプレイヤーのカメラは一つなんで、まあ動かせますけど、ズームしたりで、このままスムーズにカットシーンもつながって、カットシーンはプレイヤーが操作できないんですけども、同じようにワンカメラで情報を追っていく。でまたゲームにそのままのカメラでスッと入っていって、まあ、一つのカメラでオープニングからエンディングまでを捉えたものっていうのが ゲームとしてはすごく理想的だと思います。でそれを、数年前からやってるだけですけどね。
Now the idea is that there's always only one camera following the player constantly、with the player、controlling the character and then going into the cutscene losing control of the player of the character but still smoothly going from cutscene to、in-game and vice versa through one camera、going back into the in the game with the same cameraSo ideally, you have just this one camera from the opening of the game to the ending of the game. And well, I've just been trying to do this over these last years.
まあ、映画ではそのヒッチコックのロープとか、トゥモローワールドとかは先駆けてあのQアロンやってましたけど。
And in the film industry, you know, you have Hitchcock.
One camera, no shot.
Well, people that have been trying to do the same thing、with Hitchcock and Rope or Alfonso Cuarón that haveBeen trying to do this. There are people that have.
まあある種だからこれも映画の手法の一つだと思います。
So I think, well, this is、in a way, this is another methodology for film.
でこれを作るのが非常に今ジョーダンも分かっていると思いますが、非常に大変なんですよ。
And I'm pretty sure you're familiar to this, but doing actually trying to do this is extremely difficult.
Yes.
これ絵コンテで描いてもうまくいかないですね。
And this is, you know, even if you have、the blocking beforehand and you have all the、
まあ、ブロッキングというかそのキャラクターの配置とここでこの情報を出していく、このカメラでこれを見せてピン送りでっていうのはそのすごく計算して作らないといけないんで、非常に緻密にしないといけません。
You have to calculate in a lot of detail all these things to be able to execute it. Even then it's difficult.
まあアクションシーンとかはワンショットで撮るようなもんですよね。カット終わらずに。
It's like trying to take an action scene all to, in one cut altogether.
で大体まああの冗談もしてますけど、この人形さんとか、マップで、位置決めてどっからどう撮るっていうのをまずやります。
So well, you Jordan, you're familiar to this, but you first start with playing with dolls and putting it in a map and defining the positions where each everything will be.
でそれでまず固めて、今度自分たちでやります。CG じゃなくて、スタッフ集めて、あなたこの役、私はこの役でカメラ回して動きの確認です今度。
And now once you have this layout with the dolls, then you start doing it yourself. In our case, we get staff members, and all right, you will play this character, or this will be over here, and we try to shoot that with a camera ourselves.
で今度はプリビズで CG にそれを置いて動きも全部シミュレーションして、今度背景に何が必要か、どの距離に必要かも全部こう作っていきます。
And once that is done, then we try to do a previsualization with computer graphics, putting that in the computer, starting to calculate. All right, we need this in the background. We need this element here. We need to add this or that or subtract this.
で、それを元にセットを組んでパフォーマンスキャプチャーで動いてもらって、今度は俳優さんによってその A から B に行くスピードが変わったりするので、人の動きって全部違うので、そこで微調整をして、さらにそこでアイデアを付け加えて。ロングカットを作ります。
So and using that, then you go on set. You're doing the performance capture. You have the actors, and depending on the actors, they move at different speeds, not what you calculated, because each person moves at a different speed. So you adjust based on that, and then with once that all that is done, that's where the way you get into getting these long scenes on one cut.
であのまあ、そういうやり方なので、キャメロンがターミネーター2で溶鉱炉のシーンでやったと同じように模型を先作ってカメラを決めてしまうと、こっち側は作らなくていいので、カメラの動きと俳優の動きとセットの、レイアウトが決まると、映らないところはあのカットシーンに関してはディテールは必要ないので、そこはすごく効率がいいです。
And well, in this regard, the method that James Cameron uses, you know, having a maquette of everything, having the camera, the sets, the layouts, that allows you have you a lot of details beforehand, and that makes the process a lot more effective.
I really can't express how difficult what he's talking about is. It essentially is a ballet. Like in a normal scene, you can cut away to what you want. You can be on this person, then you can cut to a reverse. You can introduce something.The way that his cutscenes have been working lately, it goes from the in-game gameplay, it latches onto the character, it develops around, it finds someone new, it travels a distance, finds something else, comes back, and all in one continuous, unbroken thing, which becomes this incredibly complicated thing. Blocking a scene is difficult to begin with. what he's talking about is even more difficult. And to me, it's so fascinating looking at the evolution of how you made people feel something cinematic in the original Metal Gear. Snatcher and Police Knots created a much more filled and full world cinematically. And then you go into like proper sort of traditional Hollywood cinema in the original Metal Gear. And now the most cinematic version of that is actually these unbroken shots that sort of fuse the gameplay and the game. It really is masterful stuff. But specifically, when you're moving that camera around, like you told me, I brought up the gecko scene in Metal Gear 4 with Raiden, which is a masterful, it's an incredible action sequence that I think goes toe-to-toe with any contemporary action scene in existence. You told me you were taking dolls and you were moving them around to block out that whole thing. Normally that would go to a second unit director, that would go to another team. I'm proud of the fact that my action is something that I'm super hands-on with. Talk to me about taking those dolls and choreographing that whole insane ballet.
そうです、特にライデンと月光が戦うところはもう人間ではできないんで、人形でスタントの人と何度も打ち合わせして、 ここでこうしたくぐってこうしてあしてっていうのは何度もやりました。
Yeah, especially that scene, that battle scene of the geckos and Raiden, their movements impossible to achieve for people, so we were doing it endlessly with the dolls, talking with people, all right, this goes there andWe're gonna try to do this. It took quite a bit of time.
ワンショットで撮るとですね、いいんですけど、スピード感がなくなったりするんですよね。そこが非常に難しいところで。
I like to do things in one shot, but unfortunately, the downside of doing this is that feeling of speed gets lost.
そこからここからそこからここまでずっとこうカメラ寄ってドリで寄ってきたって持たないですよね。その間に情報が何もないので。
If you go from here to there and you're just dolling it that way, you know, it's not interesting as a scene altogether.
そこは頭を使わないといけない。その観客の顔を一度映して天井を映すとか、あるいはブレードランナーでリドリー・スコットがやったレイチェルが出てくるところは途中でライトで影にして一回見えなくしてパッと出すとか、そこは非常にこう頭を使うところですけど、ここが非常に面白いところですね。
That's where you really have to use your brain. I don't know, panning at the audience in between or showing something interesting. That's something that Ridley Scott, for example, did masterfully in Rachel, in that scene where she's getting close and the lights go off and then she's closer. You know, you gotta put this kind of ideas.And it's very difficult, but that's also what I find interesting and fun to think about.
もう一つそのカットシーンをワンカットにした理由っていうのがあるんですけど。
Now there's another reason that I did this for cutscenes.
ゲームって自分の時間軸で動いています。そこに間はカットされません。映画と違って、階段を上がってステージに上がるところもカットされません。普通映画では。その袖脇にいるとこなんかカットなんですけど、ゲームはそこを自分で歩いていきます。
In the games, you move on your own timeline. The time is continuous, unlike movies. And in movies, these parts where you're stepping up the stairs or just walking around would get cut. But in the game, you have to. All this is a continuous process.
ね、そうやって自分の時間のリズムでゲームをやってると、突然カットシーンで映画のカット。カットバックとかになるとちょっと違和感があるんですよね。
Now you're playing a game going through this continuous timeline and then on a cutscene then you add cuts and you the timeline changes and that feels strange to the player.
なんで僕のゲームで例えば主人公がある設備に入っていくとこも、映画で言うと入り口があってもいきなり中に入っててもいいんですけど、レストランでもいきなり席についてご飯食うててもいいんですけど、それをせずに中に入っていって椅子に座ってレストランで料理を注文するとこまでまあカットシーンでやると、いやそこはやっぱりゲームのリズム感とカットシーンのリズム感を合わせるためです。
Now in my games the way I try to do it is instead of like in a cutscene whena character goes into a restaurant, instead of just shifting from getting to the restaurant and already eating, I describe the whole thing where the character goes into the restaurant, sits in, looks at the menu, just to try not to disrupt the rhythm of the player that the game is flowing.
But where did that idea come to you? By the way, if you just want an image in your head, every time I go to Kojima Productions, it's just him playing with dolls. But where did that idea come to you? Because normally with 3D cameras, normally with virtual cameras, it's this smooth movement, it's a rapid movement, and that's what gives it a feel of being computer generated. Your work was some of the first time I was seeing those continuous moves, but done in the handheld style. So if I'm going from here to there, it's done with the rockiness of handheld, but it's not moving beyond the rate of a human. And so it feels more natural, but it's still doing impossible camera moves. So where did the idea come to you?
So,
well, the idea, I mean, I have all these images of the game in my mind. It's kind of like being in a dream where the details aren't too clear. There's sound to it, but I can't there are no details into people's faces or overall details. However, the movements and overall the impression, the feeling that I get from there, I do have a very clear idea.
なんでその自分のイメージしたものを俳優さんとかテクノロジーを使ってどんどんどんどんはっきりさせていくというか、ぼやっとしてたものを、ディテールをどんどんどんどん追加していくっていうそういうものづくりです僕の場合は。
So to that idea, to that image that I have using technology, using actors, actresses, I keep adding details into this. That's the way my method. That's my method.
One thing I've always been curious about, pretty famously in Metal Gear 4, there's several sequences that are split screen. If you were doing that as a film, would you still have chosen to do that split screen, or would you have done the more traditional Hollywood thing of cross-cutting between two different places? Because what you're doing is you're saying, this is happening here, this is happening here, which is a very standard Hollywood technique, but you chose to put both things on screen at once. So was that purely a limitation of gameplay, needed to be continuous? Or was that actually a stylistic choice that if that was being done in a movie, you still would have done that as a split screen event?
映画では知ってませんけど、スプリットスクリーンはよくやる監督とかいて、まあ、それは子供の頃から知ってたんで、こういう表現があるっていうのは当然知ってましたし。
Well, I mean, in movies, using the split screen is a fairly common methodology, so I was aware that this existed.
だから僕のやってるのはゲームなんです。ゲームを作ってるんで。
But I was creating a game.
で、ゲームでしかできないことをやったのが、方の2回あります。上下分割のシーンは。
But, so I was trying to do something unique to games. So in MGS4, there are two sections where you have this split screen.
で、1個は、レックスの上で、バンプとライデンが戦ってる。これカットシーンです。アクション、猛烈なアクション、半分、画面の右上で行われます。ここは、操作できません。見ているだけです。
So there's a scene where the top part of the screen is Rex with in a battle with Bamp and Raiden. This is an action, a scene full of action. The player can't control it.
すごい手間かかってお金もかかってます。必ず見てほしいカットではあります。そこはね。
It's a scene that I want everyone to see. I put a lot of resources and a lot of time into it.
で下が今度ゲーム自分が操作するスネークがいるんですけど。
And in the lower part of the screen, you have the part that you control with Snake.
で月光がどんどんどんどん突入してきて、それを倒していかないと。ゲームオーバーになるんですよね。
And the geckos keep coming in, and you have to defeat the geckos, otherwise you're led into a game over.
で上ではライデンがバンプと戦ってて、ライデン頑張れって言いながら自分は撃つんですけど、上を見ていると 負けてしまいます。
So on top you have Raiden and battling with Bamp, and you're cheering for Raiden. But if you put too much attention to the top part, you get defeated by the geckos.
ゲームに夢中になっているとライデンとバンプの名勝負を見逃してしまいます。
But on the other hand, if you're too focused on defeating the geckos, then you miss this very emblematic scene of the battle with Bamp and Raiden.
これがゲームですね。
This is a game.
で、もう一個は通路のところをスネークが張っていって、その上を、スネークの仲間たちが戦っているコラージュをしているところです。ここはデルトロも泣いたっていうシーンですけど。
So and the other part where I did this is a scene in the corridor with snake crawling and then the collage of snake's allies battling. This is a scene that made Guillermo del Toro himself cry.
ここはスネークが張っていくのは、まあ、ボタン連打だけなんですけど、もうボタン連打なんかもややっと言いながらも上を見ると頑張っている仲間たちを見えてよりボタンを早く押せる。
So and this is just about you know bottom mashing for snake to keep crawling, but you know it's quite exhausting to mash the button. But then you look up and you have all your allies having a hard time battling for you, so you also get motivated to keep mashing the button.
ここもまあそのゲームならではの理由があってこそ成り立つシーンです。
And this is another scene where it only exists and it's only possible because it is a game.
There may or may not be a split screen action scene in the Metal Gear movie.
No.
I want to talk to you about. Can't talk about the movie, sorry. Hit me up on Twitter. I want to talk to you about you saying that you originally wanted to be a film director.And then at some point in your career, you are working with actors in a recording studio. And now, you know, I just visited you on a mocap stage. I saw him shoot the ending to Death Stranding, so I know everything. But now you're working with actors on a mocap stage, and you've got a camera. And so for the part of you that wanted to be a film director back in the day, that now you're on that stage, you're working with actors, you're working with Norman, you're working with Mads, you're working with Leah, you're working with these titans.Talk to me about how that felt to you, how that feels to sort of fully come full circle.
そうですね。俳優さんに連絡して、説得して、信頼関係築いて、現場で指示して一緒に作るんですけど、で、レディアンアクションカットと言って、そこは映画作りと今思えばほとんど同じだと思います。
Well, yeah, definitely, you know, getting in contact with actors, actresses, meeting them, building that relationship of trust, then getting in the set and sitting there, being there and saying, ready, action. Well, that's probably the same as works in movies.
なんですけど、あくまでもゲームの一部分でしかないので、カットシーンとか、その、なんで、まあ、映画を作ってる感じではないです。やっぱりゲームを作ってるっていう、思いで演出をしてます。
But that's just one aspect of the game. Cutscenes are nothing, are but a mere part of the game. So it still doesn't feel like I'm making a movie. It completely feels like I'm making a game.
でもやっぱり日頃デジタルで作ってますので、ああいうライブっていうかその俳優さんの動きとか当然体調とか日によって違いますし、まあロケはモーキャップはしませんけど、ロケすると雨降ったり。天気も変わるんで、ああいうライブの要素を入れるっていうことは非常に僕は楽しいですね。一人でやってるんじゃなくて、いろんな俳優さんとの化学反応が必ず出るので、こう動きたい、こういうセリフに変えたいっていうのも当然言ってくれるので、そこはやっぱりデジタルでものづくりしている僕としては、非常に楽しい部分です。
However, well, another thing is that everything that I do is digital, so being thereIn the live moment with the actors, the performance they give varies depending on how they're feeling that day, how they're physically feeling that day. Also, for when I go out and do location searching, you know, those organic elements that are into it, it feels that those unique, it's really fun, those unique chemical reactions that you get on the set when an actor says, well, I think I should move this way, I would change his line with this. All those interactions are very, very fun as a person that works in a digital environment.
When I was on set, I was talking to Norman, and he said to me, you know, you guys were introduced via Guillermo, and he said to me, his favorite directors that he works with are guys who can take your idea and not shoot it down, but make it better and add something on top of it and build on it. And he was saying that very much is the way that you, the relationship that you and him have. And cultivating that relationship with actors is really difficult. Talk to me about how you've done that over the last couple of years and created room for improv. Like, you obviously have a vision in your head, but talk to me about the room that you leave for the collaboration specifically with your actors.
まあ僕そもそも完璧主義者、自分で言うのは変ですけど、なんですけど、より良くなるんであれば人の意見は当然聞きます。
Well, I'm not sure if I should say this myself, but I'm kind of a perfectionist. So if it's people, if it's ideas that people give me that make something better, I'll take them in.
でそもそも俳優さんを使うっていう、生の俳優さんをライブの俳優さんを使うっていうことはそこにプラスになるので、僕が例えばノーマンの、全身とかをスキャンして、まあ、指示して僕が動いてほしい動きをするだけなら彼を使う必要はないと思うんですけど、彼には参加してもらってる、一緒にゲームを作ってるもらってるっていう感じです。
So, in that sense, by using certain actors, certain specific actresses, I expect an input from them, a plus from them. If it was just about getting Norman in, scanning him, and just telling him what to do, and him just following that, there's no need for that person to be Norman. The idea is that he puts in his ideas and that we are creating a game together.
なんで最初ノーマンを使おうと思った時もノーマンのいいとこをすごく引き出すっていうその僕の使命があるんですけども、一緒にノーマンとサムっていうキャラクターを作っていこうというので、最初に書いた台本からかなり変わってたりする部分も当然そこはあります。でそういうのがないとあんまり面白くないですよね。
So, my idea when I started working with Norman, of course, I had this mission of showing the best of Norman, showing things that people haven't seen, aspects of Norman that people haven't seen. But also, at the same time, I wanted to create this character of Sam with Norman. The character has changed from what I originally conceived, and those changes are what makes it interesting.
で、まあ、それは松さんも、まあ、ジョーダンも来てたと思うんですけど、松ミケルセンさんもすごく提案してくれて、非常に面白い現場です。現場でしたとか。
That goes also for Mads Mikkelsen. I think you were there, but Mads always puts a lot of input, and that makes the whole shooting scene very, very interesting.
一緒に、まあ、彼来てくれた時はあのところは非常に重要なシーンで詳しいことは言えませんけど、もうマッツさんとノーマンがこうなんちゅうの。アイデアを出し合いして僕がどこまで承認するか合戦みたいなことをしてたんで非常に楽しかったですけどね。
I can't go into too much depth about the scene where Jordan, where you were in because it was a crucial scene to the game. But what I do want to mention is that Mads and Norman were putting out so much ideas, so much input, and it kind of became a thing of, all right, how much can I take of that? How much can I adapt into that? And it was a very, very fun day.
なんで実際の俳優さんを使うっていうことで、まあ、そこはあのなんでしょうね、キャスティングが全てになってくると思います。その声優さんもそうですけども、やっぱりその人を使うということで誰とやるかが重要です。それで全てが決まると思います。あのジョーダンも分かっていると思います。子役を誰にするかっていうのも重要ですので、まあ映画もゲームもやっぱりキャスティングが非常に重要になってくると思います。信頼関係をいかに築くかっていうところです。
So that's what using actors is, and casting, whether it's actors or voice actors, that is a crucial element. You could say that that is the defining element of who are you working it with. I'm pretty sure you're well aware of that. But also, even for a kid, who is that kid? That's a crucial element into films, and also is becoming an increasingly critical element into games of how you build this relationship of trust with your cast.
まあ、どっちかというと、 キューブリックとかキャメロンみたいにこういう動きをしろ、何回もしろっていうのではなく、そういうふうな、そういう自分に、もともとそういう自分なんですけど。
if I was going Kubrick, Stanley Kubrick style, James Cameron style, where you do this and you do this as many times as I tell you to do, well, that is kind of my nature. できるまでやりなさいみたいな。You know, go keep doing it until you get it done. That's kind of in my nature.
でもそれだと俳優さんとやる意味がないので、まあイーストウッドとかベン・アフレックみたいに俳優出身の人はやっぱりすごい俳優の使い方がうまいんですよね。でそこをやっぱり吸収してゲームを作るっていうことは大切だと思ってます。
So, but if you do that, then it's not interesting. It's not fun. You have directors as Clint Eastwood, as Ben Affleck, that used to be actors, and they are very, very good at getting the best of their actors. So that's something that I want to absorb and try to adapt into the way I make games.
I want to give you guys an anecdote. When I was in Tokyo last, I was sitting down with Shinji Mikami, who directed Resident Evil and Resident Evil 4, and he's equally a legend in the game community. We were talking about creation, and he said to me, creators take what they like, they consume it, they digest it, and then the art you make is kind of like the shit that comes out of your body. It always has your stench on it. And then I said that to you, and you were like, it's a good analogy, but I actually feel like it's more like puke. Because your shit doesn't have nutrients in it anymore. It's been stripped of all of that. But your puke, your vomit, still has nutrients.
Actually,
that is a little bit different.
クソゲーはゲロとうんこなんです。
I mean, bad games start in the shit.
まずうんこは食べたものを吸収して栄養がない、もうカス、残りカスです。何も残ってないもの出すんです。これクソゲーです。
Because, shit is, you know, you eat and you absorb all the proteins, all the nutrients out of that, and this, the leftovers, and that's, yeah, you could say that bad games are equivalent to that.
ゲロは消化する前のものを全部出してしまうんで、
See how animated it's
getting? 作品ではない。
Now, games, you take the best out of what you're eating and you put it out, all the nutrients, that's what you condense and you put in a game.
僕の場合は、いろんなものを吸収して、この中で、大きくした子供、あの、まあ、子供、子供みたい、自分の血と肉を分けた子供というか、そういうのが作品だと思います。
So in my case, I like to think more of, I take all these nutrients, all these things in me, and then it's like a kid for me, the best of me comes out.
It's a puke baby.
ゲロの赤ちゃん。
This is the weird fucked up relationship we have where we talk about shit and puke all day. You've talked a lot about trust and relationships, and you have led many people into battle. Filmmaking, creating stuff in my mind is battle. And so I want to talk about and bring out one of your longest collaborators that you've been working with for 20 years. If any of you have ever pretty much played a game of his, if any of you have ever looked at the incredible designs of Rex and Cyborg Ninja and the beautiful line drawings that he does and brushstroke drawings that he does, I want to bring out Yoji Shinkawa. A master. How long have you guys been working together?
20
something years, starting 94.
It's a long time. Most relationships in film do not last that long. Yoji is a master and a legend, and there are so few people in the game industry who are able to sort of create the brand that he has unto himself. They have their own collaboration, but he's this incredible artist on his own that people trip over themselves to be inspired by. I want to talk about the very first time you guys met. You've told me this story before, but what's the first memory that you have of when you interviewed with him?
監督と面接した時の話を聞かせてください。
そうですね、僕がそのまだ学生で就職をどこにしようかなと思っていろんな会社を受けようかなと思って一番最初の会社が、前回勤めてた会社なんですけどもそこの、就職面接官として小島監督がいてたんですけど
So I was still a student back then. I was thinking of where to look for a job. I was thinking of I had some game companies in mind and the first company that I applied for was a company that I was until recently and well the my first job interview was actually with him.
その時はまだそのメタルギアを作った小島監督っていう認識は僕には全然なくて、監督とそのお話しした内容っていうのを覚えてるのはほとんどその持っていったこう自分が持っていった模型の作品の話ばっかりしてたような気がしますね。
Back then I didn't know him as the creator of Metal Gear. What I can recall from that first interview, first conversation that I had with him was mostly surrounding the models that I brought in there and we were talking about whatever I brought into the interview.
面接の前に作品評価っていうのがあって彼が持ってきた絵とかいろんなものを評価するんですけどそれを見た時にですね線が枯れてるっていうんでしょうかね、学生の絵ではないうまさというかそれとやっぱアイデアがものすごくあって今まで見たこともない車のデザインとか、メカのディテールとかがあって、まあ、この人は絶対欲しいと思いました。
So actually, before the interview, there's a phase that where we criticize, where we go over the works that the students that apply submit, and well, there was something very unique to his lines. What he was drawing was not the work of a student, and also it was full of ideas. He had this ideas of cars that I have never seen. His mechs had so much detail. So at that point, I was already sold that I wanted to work with this person.
大体すごいできる人って変な人が多いんでまあ変な人やったら嫌やなとで線が枯れてるんでまあ35億のおっさんかなと思ったらしんちゃんがこのまま現れてちょっとびっくりしましたね。すごいギャップでした。作ったものと本人の雰囲気というのが
And well people that are so good especially artists his lines were so special so thin that people like this tend to be very very weirdstrange people so I pictured this weird 35-36 weirdo and then you know Yoji as he is just showed up and there was a huge gap between the idea that I had made of him and the person that showed up
で、まあ、しんちゃんも今模型の話してましたけど、その会社の試験で、なんか課題があるんですけど
亀でしたよね。
亀をいろんなものに展開させる。
そうですね。
で、大体持ってくるのは絵です。大体ってほとんど 100%、うん、まあ油絵の人もいればね、パステルでとかで描いてる人もいますけど、絵を持ってきます。まあ大体 2,3 日かけて持ってくるんでしょうけど、それで評価をするんですけど。
So Yoji mentioned the models, the sculptures that he brought.Actually, in the company, there was a test where the people were asked, I think the theme was turtles, yes, it was definitely turtles, where they were asked to make a motif out of turtles and then expand on that theme of turtles. And most people, I'd say 100% of people that applied, they brought their paintings, their drawings, different techniques. They spent 2-3 days creating this art, this work.
で、しんちゃんはこんなフルスクラッチのうん、立体物を持ってきたんです。こんなでかい
粘土をこねてこんなガメラみたいな、はい、出来損ないでした
よ。いやいやすごい出来がいいんで。
And Shinten, he brought a full scale like Gamera model made from scratch from clay.
はい。でもう出来がいいんで面接じゃなくどうやって作ったのかとか、この素材は何なのかと。
It was so well
done
that you know I put his job interview totally aside and just ask him like, well, how you made this? Like, What is the detail?
あの値段まで聞いてましたね、素材のね。
そうですね、どこで買ったんだって言われて、いや普通のお店で買ったんです、ね、
なかなかあの当時あれ売ってなかったんで。
Yeah, he was asking like, all right, where do you find this material? Because it was material very unusual. And he was like, actually it's not that strange. It's fairly common stuff. And you know, that was a conversation back
then. でもその時はですね、あの他の部署の人と一緒に面接してるんで、まあ、しんちゃんが欲しいんで、どうやってしんちゃんを僕の部署に入れるかっていう、それしか考えてなかったです。
And at that point, because I was not the only person interviewing him, there were people from other divisions of the company also interviewing him. All I was thinking is, how do I get this guy to my team?
危なかったですよね。もうちょっとでヘンリーエクスプローラーズっていうなんか変なシューティングを作るあの人形を実際にアーマチュア組んでコマ撮りをして、それを取り込んだやつをこうプレイヤーが打つっていうアーケードゲームがあったんですけど、もうちょっとでそこに行きそうになりました。
Actually, I almost went elsewhere. There was this weird game called Henry Explorers. It was a shooting game where like dolls were, the players were shooting the dolls, some dolls that were put in the game, some arcade style game, and I was almost assigned to that team.
The reason I bring that up is a couple of reasons. One, just the image of like a little baby Shinkawa-san bringing in a little statue that he looks at and nerds out about. But also, he was fresh out of school. This is one of the most iconic relationships in gaming in my mind, and they met so early on. I think it's so incredible. One quick thing, we had some technical difficulties up front, so you guys probably want to hear us talk for like another 5 minutes, right? I think you should say that louder. So that they hit. Okay, there we go. So communicating a vision is one of the hardest things to do in filmmaking and creating anything. When the two of you collaborate, when you say, I have this idea for a mech, but it's almost more like a kaiju than a mech. When you say, I have this robot ninja character, talk to me just about the process of how it goes from something that you're saying to something that you're doing, that you're bringing back. I want to sort of illuminate to them what that process is and how it works.
メタルギアのレックスは、あの恐竜のレックスみたいな歩き方をして吠えるのが欲しいな、しんちゃん。
ジュラシックパークがね、やってたんですよね。
いやもうレックス好きなんで。
For Rex, for example, I brought to Shinchan like, hey, I want something like a Tyrannosaurus Rex. Oh yeah, you were so into Jurassic Park, right?
But then what about Ninja? What about these other characters?
であのレックスはしんちゃんが二次元で永遠描くんですよね。
そうですね、
なかなかいいものができない、
はい、
すごいやってたもんね。
結構1ヶ月以上悩んでた、
うん、でそこでしんちゃんは模型もできるんで、うん、じゃあ家で模型を作ってきたらっていうので、
は
い、それ
で家で、そうですね、
家に帰って電話で報告するんで、今日このぐらいできました、はい、っていうので立体で、当初から最初から立体でしんちゃんが考えて作ったデザインがメタルギアのレックスなんで。
So he started working at it, but he was just doing paint, drawing it in 2D and spent about a month and it didn't went well and did so many designs and wasn't going well. So he suggested, all right, why don't you make a sculpture out of it? Just go home and stay there and just make the sculpture and just report to me on the phone. We'll talk on the phone daily. Just you tell me how you're progressing. And so Rex, actually, from the beginning, it was made as a sculpture.
で、ニンジャは、
はい、家で模型をしてお金もらえるってすごいいいなと思いました。
And for me, it was fantastic. I was just like, right, I'm just making a sculpture at home and I'm getting paid to do this. It's awesome.
あの、シンナーとか吸って、しんちゃんどう大丈夫かなって言うんで、夜にいつも電話をして大丈夫かって
時々ね家まで来て、
時々遊びにあの帰りしんちゃんの家まで行って大丈夫かと、診断吸ってへんかみたいな。
And my, and I was worried, you know, with the sculptures, are you inhaling too much thinner or something? Are you okay? I was calling home the phone. Every now and then I would drop by on my way back from the company to his house and see if he was doing okay, if he was not intoxicated with thinner.
あの忍者の場合は逆で、僕がいろんなキャラを頼んでたんですけど、ラフがどんどん来るんですけど、落書きみたいなのがあって、はい、そこに忍者の原型みたいなのがあって、これ何やこれみたいな、 忍者ですみたいな。
そうですね。どこが忍者やねんって形ですけどね。
For Cyber Ninja was the opposite case where he asked him to do different characters, different sketches from characters. He brought the sketches. They were almost like doodles. And then he said like, I asked him like, what is this? And he said, it's a ninja. It's like, doesn't look like a ninja at all.
なんで、脚本も全部書き直して忍者を入れて、そこからまたやり取りをしてっていう感じです。
So, but I had to go back and rewrite the script so that ninja could be in the game, and well, from there we started going again back and forth.
本当にまあ自分たちが作りたいものとか自分がかっこいいって思ってたものをただ純粋にこう吐き出していってたっていうような印象はあります。
My feeling back then was that I was just being able to output what I really wanted to make, what I thought it was cool. That is what I was being asked to do. So that was my impression of back then.
So last question. What is something that you've given him a prompt on that he came back with something that was just infinitely better and changed your mind about something and he added something new to it? And then for you, what's something, just talk to me about a memory on something that the two of you struggled on or that you didn't think would work, and talk to me about sort of a breakthrough moment.
So, 今回のノーマンのスーツはすごい苦戦しましたけどね。
When it comes to difficulties, Norman suit that we made for this time was very, very difficult.
今までのヒーローとは違うちょっとブルーカラーなで装備品もそういう方向でっていうオファーだったんですけど、まあそこは結構時間をかけて。
Wanted something unlike a hero, something more blue collar, and some equipment that represented that, and that we took a lot of time doing that.
あとそうです。一番最初は全然こうライデンのスカルスーツみたいな、そんなちょっともっと SF 感の強い、まあラバースーツみたいな感じだったんですけど、まあ実際にゲームの中で動かしてみたらやっぱ違和感があるというか世界観に違うのかなっていうので監督と相談してもっと普通がいいんじゃっていうことでいろいろ練り直して今の形になってますけど、
まあカラーリングもそうですけどね。
So at the beginning it was more of like a school suit, like kind of the one that Raiden is wearing, more science fiction-ish, more like a rubber suit, but when implementing that into the game it didn't feelNaturally, it didn't feel like it was fitting that world. So, you know, we tried many different options. He told me to try something, maybe something more natural, something more normal. And, well, through those iterations,
ベノムスネークの時に僕はもうあれ悪魔なんでここに角を両方生やしてくれと。で、尻尾をつけたかったんですよ。悪魔の尻尾。それを発注するので固くなに嫌ですと。
For Venom Snake, he was supposed to be a devil. He has this horn, and I kept asking him, like, put a devil's tail into him. I really want, and he just kept saying, no way, nope, not gonna happen.
両方嫌なんでこっちに2本つけます。
So he really didn't want to put that devil tail, so instead he put the horn.
僕も尻尾はいいから、じゃあスリングが1本垂れて、たまに見る人が見たら尻尾に見えるみたいな、それでどうみたいな。
And then at some point I gave up on the idea of the tail. I was like, all right, never mind the devil tail, but just maybe some sleeve, something that some people at some point maybe get the impression that looks like a tail.
すごい、でもね、それでかっこよくなったと思いますし。
But yeah, I think that actually made the character look cool.
Very frequently I tell my artists, I'm like, do this thing, and they're like, that's stupid. And then I have to convince them to do it. And eventually you figure out the way to get that one horn.we have to wrap it up. Thank you guys for coming. Hopefully we'll be back next year for a part 3. Also, as a fun fact, today is 31 days away from the 31st anniversary of the release of Metal Gear on the MSX. please give it up for the legendary Yoji Shinkawa. The man himself, Hideo Kojima. Tell them you want us back next year.
Thank you.
Thank you.